ओम परतत्वे सदा लीनो रामकृष्ण समाज्ञया यो धर्मस्थापनरतो वीरेशं तं नमाम्यहम्। इन स्वामी विवेकानंदस कर्मयोग वे आर रीडिंग दि सिक्स्थ चैप्टर। The name of the chapter is Non-Attachment is Complete Self-Abnegation. And I told you the meaning of the name. Self-abnegation is non-attachment. To achieve non-attachment, you have to completely annihilate your ego. Ego is not in the sense of egoistic Admi. The very sense of I, the small I, that is called ego philosophically. And that is called self, with the small s, whatever we feel today as I. And unless whatever you feel today as I is negated totally, you cannot achieve non-attachment. That is the meaning of the title of this chapter. And as I told you, you can take that up till now, whatever we have learned, except that in the secret of karma, everything was preliminary in a sort. And here we have entered the depths of what Swamiji calls Karma Yoga. And the idea of Karma Yoga is do karma without attachment. And Swamiji has told this is not possible. Non-attachment has to be achieved. And it is a lifelong work almost. So how to achieve that? And the principle behind that is the more you can refuse to accept your I, the more you can negate your I, the more you are unattached. That is the only way to non-attachment. Many people feel we are living non-attached, but when we find if anything impinges their house, their sons, their family, their friend circle, their mind, their body, then the reaction comes. So, non-attachment full, which is the basis of Karma Yoga, can be achieved only when the I is totally negated, I is totally annihilated, self-abnegation. Then what will happen? You won't land into zero by annihilating I, because this I is unreal. This I is a mere reflection. The sun does not go away by your destroying the reflected light in a pot. You are reflecting your face in the mirror. If the mirror is broken, you are not gone away. In the same way, this I is only a mere reflection. So, the reality inside you, we, everybody, inside all of us, there is one common reality. That is what Swamiji has been telling up till now. One common reality. It reflects in each body-mind complex, psychosomatic complex as they call it. I. I am a boy, I am a girl, I am so and so, I am so and so, I am a doctor, I am... All this is the reflection, passing reflection of the one consciousness which pervades the entire universe. And when this small I is suppressed, repressed, both are not correct words, when this small I is transcended into the reality, then that is the real ideal Karma Yoga. So, that is very name of this chapter. And in the beginning what we read is there is a universal field. Field, when I say energy, universal field. That means if I do good, I am adding a force to the universal good. If I am doing something bad, I am adding a universal force to the universal bad. And if I am doing bad, I am influenced by the universal bad. If I am doing good, I am influenced by the universal good. That is the principle Swamiji has told up till now. And side by side he has also said that no action is 100% good or 100% bad. And therefore he has told us that we cannot reach perfection by work, because work means some good and some bad, maybe maximum good and little bad, but that good remains. So, what is the solution? And the solution is to be unattached. And how to be unattached? By self-abnegation. So, we come to this para. In between, I am reading some sentences of what we already read to remind us perfection can never be attained by work. And the second point to consider is what is the end of work. So, if perfection cannot be attained by work, then why are we working? There are two answers. We are working because we cannot keep quiet. That is the one main answer. And these various motivations Swamiji has shown. So what could be our motivation in that work? Why are we working? In the spiritual sense is the question. What we gain spiritually by work? That is the Swamiji's question. Work we are doing because we cannot stop doing work, non-work. So we are working. But then what is its relation to our spiritual progress or spiritual life? That is the meaning of the question, what is the end of work? And after discussing many things, Swamiji himself has given the reply, the main effect of work done for others is to purify ourselves. And that in the previous chapter, Swamiji had clearly told that we help ourselves, not the world. So that attitude changes, that arrogance changes, that superiority complex changes. And we know that we are spiritually growing. So purify ourselves. And then, not I but thou, Swamiji says, is the principle. I read the last lines of the para which we read. But his ideas of ethics, if they are really good, cannot but be based on the highest self-abnegation. Now Swamiji calls it highest. He is referring to the personalist, dualist. All dualists think, I cannot merge in God, I want to remain separate. If you want to remain separate, something of I is sticking to you, and you cannot have complete self-abnegation. So Swamiji says, and they may theoretically think that they will remain separate. But if you read their ideas of ethics, if we are less selfish, we are better. Then why not fully unselfish? And fully unselfish possible only when there is no I. So the name changes. Instead of unselfish, we call selfless man. So when the I is annihilated, that is the ideal of every moral science. That is the ideal of every ethical science. That is the ideal for every spiritual growth. Whether in the beginning you are a believer of your individuality or not, but if you want to follow Karma Yoga, you must try to, we all must try to attain the total self-abnegation. Now in this respect, Swamiji has quoted an ancient shloka. And that shloka I wrote down just now, and I asked the Advaita Ashram to put it on the chat. You will see that. Those who can read Sanskrit, I am chanting that shloka now before reading this. The para which we are reading today, you will find various classes of men in this world. This is based upon a Sanskrit Subhashita shloka. And Swamiji's version may be Swamiji's version may be slightly, he has made a free translation. Ete sat purusha parartha ghataka swarthan parityajyaye temi man samanyastu parartha mudyama bhruta swartha virodhenaye temi manusha rakshasa parahitam स्वार्थाय निघ्नन्ति ये तु घ्नन्ति निरर्थकं परहितं ते केन जानीमहे. We read what Swamiji is telling us. First, there are the God-men. In the shloka, Satpurusha. Satpurusha, Swamiji has translated as God-men. First, there are the God-men whose self-abnegation is complete. and who do only good to others, even at the sacrifice of their own life. Swarthan parityajya in the shloka, giving up total consideration for themselves, they are totally, completely busy in doing good to others. These are the highest of men. If there are 100 of such in any country, that country need never despair. 100 in one country of millions. If 100 are there, the country never need not despair, Swamiji says. But they are unfortunately too few. Then there are the good men. In the shloka it is samanya man, ordinary man. But Swamiji has called them good men. But there are the good men who do good to others as long as it does not injure themselves. They will protect their whatever they want and then do good to others as much as they can. This is the samanya manush. We see this man in generality. Generality is this type of man. So there are good persons. And there is a third class. Third class in the shloka, rakshasas in the form of men, manusha rakshasa, third class, who to do good to themselves, injure others. And then, it is said by a Sanskrit poet that there is a fourth unnameable class of people who injure others merely for injury's sake. So in the main shloka, teke na jani mahe, I do not know what name to give to them, he says. Yetu gnanti nirarthakam, without any gain to themselves, they are just bent upon destroying others. Teke na jani mahe, I cannot name them. And their number is increasing, you may say. So, just as there are at one pole of existence the highest good men who do good for the sake of doing good, so at the other end, other pole, there are others who injure others just for the sake of the injury. In Hindi, Giridhar is a kavi. And he has said that, he has given the example of jute. He said, we put juice in water, we make it rotten and then we heat it. And the jute wants all this, so that a rope can be made and others can be bound by that. He has equated these people of this type. They do not gain anything thereby. But it is their nature to do evil. Now, Swamiji is telling something special for the Karma Yogis, and that he introduces by telling there are two Sanskrit words. The one is pravritti, which means revolving towards. Vritta means revolve, circle. Pra means towards. Pravritti means circling towards. Circling towards. That is pravritti. And the other is nivritti, which means revolving away. Rather, revolving away from a person, revolving inside us. Nivritti means like this, circling inside. Circling towards, circling away from others. They are the two words, pravritti and nivritti. The revolving towards is what we call the world. World is the result of pravritti, the I and mine. So I and mine revolving towards objects always. I itself is defined always in relation to some object. Mine. Some object. So I and mine predominating or I and mine involved, that is called pravritti. It includes all those things which are always encircling that me by wealth and money and power and name and fame, and which are of a grasping nature, always tending to accumulate everything in one center, that center being myself, small self. That is the pravritti. And then Swamiji calls it the natural tendency of every human being. Natural tendency of every human being. You have to remember this. If you take any individual, other than the manifestation of the universal in that individual, you take an individual, you define the individual, consciousness associated with a particular body and mind. If it is associated or limited by only one particular body and mind, what could be the easiest, what could be the natural outcome? Analyze and find out and tell me. Ego, selfishness, enjoyment, narrowness. These are the automatic outcome of what we call an individual. When we find something else in that individual, that is, you must say, the divine grace, that is the manifestation of the universal which is in us. We have come out of the universal and become individual. And universal is nearer to our real nature, which is transcendent over everything. So, normal individual, Swamiji is telling, natural tendency of every human being is taking everything from everywhere and heaping it around one center, that center being man's own sweet self. Again I repeat, ego, selfishness, enjoyment, narrowness. Whenever we say narrowness in this world, my family, my caste, my religion, my country, that is the expression of the individual. Ego, I will do this, you cannot, I will do. Selfishness, I want this for myself, I want this for myself. Swamiji has told, when he went to the West, he found every man for himself and devil take the hindmost. Everybody is running a race. Those who are at the backside, devil take them. So, that is the individuality. I told you another story that day. 31st December, bombing on London in the night. And a man is sitting at the table and is praying, "Oh God, save me and my wife, my son and his wife, and no, we four and no more." No, he actually included four, otherwise myself only. So that is the center being man's own sweet self. When this tendency begins to break, that means the other unselfish idea is coming, entering, that I should not be like this, I should help others as much as possible. I am reminded of one thing here, again and again it hits me. In our school, the Boy Scout, I don't know whether all of you are aware of an organization called Boy Scouts. It was started in England by Lord Baden Powell. And because of the beauty of it, it was adopted in India also. And schools, not colleges, but schools, young individuals, old individuals, they became Boy Scouts. In our school, the Boy Scout was quite ideal and strong. In the whole city, our school Boy Scout was supposed to be the best. And first principle of Boy Scout is every day I shall do something to help others. And this is not just a written rule, because in our school at least, the scout meetings would not be every day of the week, maybe 2 days or 3 days a week, maybe 2 days. But as soon as we used to go to the meeting, the scout master would ask first, what did you, good you do today? Then we used to tell, what can we do? Then he instructed us, when you are coming to school, you may find some lame man, some blind man, some old man, unable to cross the street. You could hold his hand and help him cross the street. If you find a burning cigarette or some thorn or glass piece on the road, you could take it and put it aside. So that entered this. Every day would ask, what good have you done today? So this became ingrained. I cannot claim for everybody. At least my very mind has been built upon this principle. And then when I joined the Ramakrishna Mission, I saw the infinite dimension of this. Do as much as you can for others. No question of expectation. Do as much as you can for others. So this unselfishness in my life at least started in the school due to the Boy Scout movement. And today, I don't know, whatever I am, but I am extremely grateful to our school Boy Scouts. I am repeating our school because in other places this is taken very formally. But it was an ideal in our school. People may have become interested, anyway, may not be. DAV school in Gwalior, Madhya Pradesh, India. Anyway, so that is the ideal. Swamiji calls it when it has started breaking. This is the start of the breaking. When the tendency begins to break, when it is nivritti or going away from, then begin morality and religion. Then begin morality and religion. And Swamiji has very clearly stated this. I always feel that any sign of spiritual progress is first how much unselfish you are becoming. Without that, only by meditation, narrowness rate is increasing, you are not growing spiritual. How much unselfish you are becoming. Swamiji calls it here the beginning of morality and religion. Both pravritti and nivritti are of the nature of work. Now here, because of vritti, Swamiji has translated this rightly. In the ancient scriptures, say by Shankaracharya, or any ancient scriptures, pravritti means work, nivritti means not work. But Swamiji has clearly stated here, pravritti means selfish work, nivritti means unselfish work. Both are of the nature of work. Even if you meditate, is it not work? So long as the I does not vanish, everything which you are doing is work only. When the very idea, I am the doer, vanishes, then only we are gone beyond the world. And then only we experience God, not till then. That Swamiji has shown that even the dualistic or individualistic religion, they have to accept complete self-abnegation as the ideal. And in India, plenty of stories. Swamiji has given those stories also. The former is evil work and the latter is good work. This nivritti is the fundamental basis of all morality and all religion. So gradually it grows, and then when we transcend the very idea of I am the doer, then what Shankaracharya and others call nivritti, it begins at that time. In the Gita, आरुरुक्षोर मुनेर योगम कर्म कारणम उच्यते योगारूढस्य तस्यैव शमः कारणम उच्यते. सो दैट ऑटोमेटिकली टेक्स प्लेस एंड द वेरी परफेक्शन ऑफ इट इज एंटायर सेल्फ एब्नेगेशन. देन ओनली द नॉन अटैचमेंट रीचेस इट्स कल्मिनेशन. परफेक्शन ऑफ निवृत्ति इज सेल्फ एब्नेगेशन. निष्कर्म सिद्धि इट इज कॉल्ड. नो आई. इन प्रैक्टिकल लाइफ समझे ट्रांसलेटेड रेडीनेस टू सैक्रिफाइस माइंड एंड बॉडी एंड एवरीथिंग फॉर अनदर बीइंग. माइंड एंड बॉडी एंड एवरीथिंग फॉर अदर्स. When a man has reached that state, he has attained to the perfection of Karma Yoga, then we are doing Karma Yoga perfectly. Or through Karma Yoga we reach the highest. This is the highest result of good works. So that is the definition of good work. Although I am, as man has not studied a single system of philosophy, although he does not believe in any God, theory is this. Swamiji has already told there is God in the universe. But suppose we do not believe in God but become more and more unselfish. I sometimes wonder at this. I would just jokingly commenting, you need not have read any philosophy but you should have read Swamiji's Karma Yoga. Otherwise, how do you understand this? The idea of Nivritti you understood only by reading Swamiji's Karma Yoga. So though Swamiji says you need not read any philosophy, but it does not exclude reading Swamiji's Karma Yoga. And it cannot be without Swamiji's Karma Yoga. When a man has reached that state, he has attained the perfection of Karma Yoga. This is the highest result of good works. Although a man has not studied a single system of philosophy, that means if it is natural in him, then it is a different thing. Although he does not believe in any God, he does not even think of what is God. He simply thinks that I should not be myself, I should be for others. And never has believed God. Although he has not prayed even once in his whole life, if the simple power of good actions has brought him to that state where he is ready to give up his life and all else for others, he has arrived at the same point to which the religious man will come through his prayers and the philosopher through his knowledge. And so you may find that the philosopher, the worker and the devotee all meet at one point, that one point being self-abnegation. That day I gave an example which came to my mind. Karma Yoga is like rubbing a piece of sandalwood. Rub out completely, only sweet smell remains, fragrance. Bhakti Yoga is like sugar being dissolved in some solution or water. You do not remain, only God remains. Jnana Yoga is like camphor, just put a matchstick and it has gone. So all three are only self-abnegation. And if you want to include Raja Yoga into that, you bury a man deep into sand, he will die one day. Everywhere self-abnegation. However much their systems of philosophy and religion may differ, all mankind stand in reverence and awe before the man who is ready to sacrifice himself for others. Here it is not at all any question of creed or doctrine. Even men who are very much opposed to all religious ideas, when they see one of these acts of complete self-sacrifice, feel that they must revere it. Have you not seen even a most bigoted Christian, when he reads Edwin Arnold's Light of Asia, stand in reverence of Buddha, who preached no God, preached nothing but self-sacrifice? Edwin Arnold, being Christian, but he was so much influenced by or used to love Indian philosophy, that three great Indian books he has translated into English poetry. Kathopanishad, he says, song of death. Bhagavad Gita, he called the song celestial. And Bhagavan Buddha's life, light of Asia. These three are poetical books by Sir Edwin Arnold. So Swamiji said, the Christians will not like the idea of Advaitism. They will say, I want to be an individual. But see how much he has adored Bhagavan Buddha, who preached no God, preached nothing but self-sacrifice. The only thing is that the bhagavad does not know that his own end and aim in life is exactly the same as that of those from whom he differs. So bhagavad, that means narrow about his own sect, which may be dualistic. But what is his end? To dissolve in God. So he is coming to the same self-abnegation. Those who do not believe in God, but they are totally self-abnegation, so same thing has come to. The worshipper, by keeping constantly before him the idea of God and a surrounding of good, idea of God and a surrounding of good, not that you do bad works and only think of God, like the Dakate Kali in Calcutta. The dacoits Kali, they worship Kali and do dacoitry, not that. So Swamiji has given a rider here. Worship of God and surrounding of good. Comes to the same point at last and says, thy will be done. And keeps nothing to himself. That is self-abnegation. The philosopher, with his knowledge, sees that seeming self is a delusion. So for philosopher, for jnani, this small self does not exist at all. It is a delusion. And easily gives it up. It is self-abnegation. So bhakti, apparently dualistic, but you completely dissolve yourself in God, so self-abnegation. Jnani knows that the small self is unreal, so self-abnegation. The karmi, through absolute unselfishness, come to self-abnegation. Swamiji has not included yoga in his discussion here. So karma, bhakti and jnana all meet here, and this is what was meant by all the great preachers of ancient times when they taught that God is not the world. God is not the world means God will not be obtained unless there is unselfishness. That is the meaning of God is not the world. There is one thing which is the world and another thing which is God. World here, Swamiji, means selfishness. Another is God. And this distinction is very true. What they mean by world is selfishness. Swamiji just told it here itself. Unselfishness is God. One may live on a throne in a golden palace and be perfectly unselfish. So it also does not depend upon outside. Good means outside unselfishness, but does not depend upon what type of life your pattern of life is. A king can be absolutely unselfish. The great example of Janaka is always quoted. Rama is always quoted for this. And then he is in God, in God. Another may live in a hut and wear rags and have nothing in the world. Yet if he is selfish, he is intensely merged in the world. To come back to one of our main points, we say that, Swamiji has come back to that point now. He has described pravritti and nivritti, good man and bad man, and now he has come back to the point that by work we cannot gain it. That point he has come to know back. To come back to one of our main points, we say that we cannot do good without at the same time doing some evil, or do evil without doing some good. Knowing this, how can we work? There have therefore been sects in this world who have, in an astoundingly preposterous way, preached slow suicide as the only means to get out of the world. Swamiji has not named it, but is clearly referring to Jainism. Do not eat. Some worm you may eat. Do not drink. Some worm may go. Do not breathe. Some worm may go. And so, what is the result? Slow suicide. And Swamiji says, when you die, your corpse will rot and trouble others. So that cannot be the solution. Swamiji has named Jains. Swamiji has named. There have been therefore been sects in this world who have, in an astoundingly preposterous way, preached slow suicide as the only means to get out of the world, because if a man lives, he has to kill poor little animals and plants, or do injury to something or someone. Plants have life. People say, eating flesh is bad. You are killing somebody. What about this bottle gourd and pumpkin? Are we not killing them? They have life. We do not feel in a cross way, so we do not think about it. So don't eat. He has to kill poor little animals and plants, or do injury to something or someone. So, according to them, the only way out of this world is to die. The Jainas have preached this doctrine as their highest ideal. This teaching seems to be very logical, but the true solution is found in the Gita. Seems to be logical, but it is illogical. That is the meaning of seems to be. But the true solution is found in the Gita. It is the theory of non-attachment. If you are not killing, if you are not involved in the killing, then you have no sin. If you try to remove your I from every action, then you have no sin. Even fighting wars, in the Gita, Bhagavan is again and again telling Arjuna about ahimsa. And again and again telling, kill them, kill them, kill them. Duty, we have seen that duty portion. The world is suffering, so kill them. It is the theory of non-attachment, to be attached to nothing while doing our work of life. Know that you are separated entirely from the world, though you are in the world. You are connected with the world because selfishness. And that whatever you may be doing in it, you are not doing that for your own sake. So you start like this. You are not doing for yourself. Any action that you do for, you say impossible, impossible. If you have to reach freedom, if you have to reach God, whatever name you tell, then you have to proceed on this way. That is Swamiji is again and again telling us. Any action that you do for yourself will bring in its effect, will bring its effect to bear upon you. If it is a good action, you will have to take the good effect. And if bad, you will have to take the bad effect. But any action that is not done for your own sake, whatever it be, will have no effect on you. There is to be found a very expressive sentence in our scriptures embodying this idea. Gita. Even if we kill the whole universe, or be himself killed. He is neither the killer nor the killed when he knows that he is not acting for himself at all. Gita 18th chapter. Yasya naham kruto bhavo buddhir yasya nalipyate hatvapi sa iman lokan na antina nibadyate. Now the Indian religion knows that God himself is the destroyer. So if we judge by our standards, is he not the highest sinner when he destroys the whole world? But he says, no, I am not destroying, it is going away by its own. So when I is not involved, there is no sin. That is the idea. In this respect, I will quote you Holy Mother. Once boy went to Holy Mother and said, if God is the doer, I am not the doer, then even the bad things what I am doing is God's doing. Mother countered this by asking him a question. My boy, you are talking by mouth or from your heart? By mouth you are talking, inside that is not the belief. By heart if you are talking, you will never do anything bad. This I itself is the source of all bad things. That's how we just showed. If really you know that God is the doer, not you, then bad will not come out of you at all. So saying by mouth will not do. So when he asked the question, mother said, my boy, you are saying it by mouth or from your heart? Therefore, Karma Yoga teaches, do not give up the world. Live in the world, imbibe its influences as much as you can, but if it be for your own enjoyment's sake, work not at all. Enjoyment should not be the goal. On the first page, Swami just told, knowledge only is the goal, not pleasure. Enjoyment. I am reminded here of my Guruji. He abhorred the word enjoyment. The very word enjoyment was abhorring to him. And these days it is so common. People ask, did you enjoy that? Did you enjoy that? He says, why enjoy? You can be filled with bliss unselfishly. You can be filled with bliss thinking of God. Why enjoy? Enjoy means subject enjoying the object. That is the idea. But you can have happiness, you can have bliss, you can have the highest bliss without enjoying. Actually, if we go to enjoy the happiness in deep sleep, we have to wake up again. So enjoyment is not the solution. Do not give up the world, live in the world, imbibe its influence as much as you can, but if it be for your own enjoyment's sake, work not at all. Enjoyment should not be the goal. First kill yourself and then take the whole world as yourself. As soon as the individual goes, the cosmic shines. Individual is only a shadow of the cosmic. Even better to call it shadow than a reflection. And if that shadow goes away, the reality remains. This is Karma Yoga. First kill yourself and then take the whole world as yourself. As the old Christians used to say, the old man must die. So the meaning in every religion is the same, if we can find it out. So Swamiji has used Christianity to prove to the Christians, the old man must die, means I. This I or selfishness is called the old man. When he's died, new man comes, which is unselfish, which is a devotee, which is a jnani. This old man is the selfish idea that the whole world is made for our enjoyment. Foolish parents teach their children to pray, O Lord, Thou hast created this sun for me and this moon for me, as if the Lord has had nothing else to do than to create everything for these babies. Do not teach your children such nonsense. Then again, There are people who are foolish in another way. They teach us that all these animals were created for us to kill and eat, and that this universe is for the enjoyment of men. That creates bondage and bondage and bondage. That is all foolishness, Swamiji calls it, because it is untrue, so foolishness. A tiger may say, giving an extreme example helps us to understand how it is wrong. A tiger may say, man was created for me, and pray, O Lord, how wicked are those men who do not come and place themselves before me to be eaten. They are breaking your law. If the world is created for us, we are also created for the world. That this world is created for our enjoyment is the most wicked idea that holds us down, binds us. This world is not for our sake. Millions pass out of it every year. The world does not feel it. Millions of others are supplied in their place. Just as much as the world is for us, so we are also for the world. To work properly, therefore, you have first to give up the idea of attachment. Secondly, do not mix in the fray. Hold yourself as a witness and go on working. My master used to say, look upon your children as a nurse does. Sri Ramakrishna has said, look upon your children as a nurse does in a rich man's house. This is important. Which is the rich man's house? Who is the rich man? In your own house, you may be poor or rich, but your house does not belong to you. It belongs to God. God is the rich man. God is the richest man. You are dealing with your own children, but don't say they are my children. They are your children, so you have to serve them. But a nurse, Swamiji has given an example, she says, my child, my son, my Rama, my Lalu, and when she is dismissed, she has to go away, find some other my Ramas, my Lalus. So, in that sense, this attitude has to be there while dealing in our own house. I would extend it and say, same should apply and applies to our own ashramas. The nurse will take your baby and fondle it and play with it and behave towards it as gently as if it were her own child, as if. But as soon as you give her notice to quit, she is ready to start off bag and baggage from the house. Everything in the shape of attachment is forgotten. It will not give the ordinary nurse, because she is working for money only, profession only, the least bang to leave your children and take up other children. Babysitters are there in the West. It is simply a profession. Even so are you to be with all that you consider your own. You are the nurse, and if you believe in God, that is easy. Swamiji says, even if you do not believe in God, you can do karma yoga. But again and again, by force of context, he has to bring in God. The way becomes very smooth. And if you believe in God, believe that all these things which you consider yours are really His. The greatest weakness often insinuates itself as the greatest good and strength. What is the greatest weakness? It is a weakness to think that anyone is dependent on me. That is the most important thing. If you think people in your family are dependent on you, you have become slave to them. And that I can do good to others. This belief is the mother of all our attachment. And through this attachment comes all our pain. So if you are not the doer, no self, no attachment. We must inform our minds. So what is the practice in Karma Yoga? Mental input. You understand? On the first day we thought what practices Swamiji wants us to do. Here is one of them. We must inform our minds that no one in this universe depends upon us. Not one beggar depends upon our charity. Not one soul on our kindness. Not one living thing on our help. All are helped on by nature. And we'll be so helped even though millions of us were not there. It is his karma. Swamiji in the first page has told that karma. His karma phal of the previous life is such that though he is poor, money is coming to him. Your karma is that you carry it to him. The course of nature will not suffer such as you and me. It is, as already pointed out, only a blessed privilege to you and to me that we are allowed in the way of helping others to educate ourselves. Purify, you are telling up till now, he is telling educate. This is a great lesson to learn in life, and when we have learnt it fully, we shall never be unhappy. That is the main thing. How to find happiness? We have no expectation, no pain. We can go on and mix without harm in society anywhere and everywhere. You may have wives and husbands and regiments of servants and kingdoms to govern if only you act on the principle that the world is not for you and does not inevitably need you, they can do you no harm. This very year some of your friends may have died. Is the world waiting without going on for them to come again? Is its current stopped? No, it goes on. So drive out of your mind the idea that you have to do something for the world. The world does not require any help from you. In a different context, Swamiji has told all this. Now for in this chapter of self-abnegation, he is bringing that idea again. It is sheer nonsense on the part of any man to think that he is born to help the world. It is simply pride, it is selfishness insinuating itself in the form of virtue. Tremendous. Remember that story of Rockefeller. He said, now you must thank me. Swamiji said, you have to thank me. When you have trained your mind and your nerves to realize this idea, these are the practices of Karma Yoga, mind you. Not only doing karma, when you have trained your mind and your nerves to realize this idea of the world's non-dependence on you or on anybody, there will then be no reaction in the form of pain resulting from birth. So, we have to train our mind and our nerves to realize this idea of the world's non-dependence on you or on anybody. There will then be no reaction in the form of pain resulting from birth. How to train your nerves, you may ask me? Training your mind, and when you practice that bodily, then you train your nerves also. It should become instinct like thinking. When you give something to a man and expect nothing, do not even expect the man to be grateful. His ingratitude will not tell upon you. That day I quoted Shakaranda Swamiji. Because you never expected anything, never thought you had any right to anything in the way of a return, you gave him what he deserved. You are only the carrier of that. One of my teachers told me, the Marathi word for frustration is apeksha bhanga, the failure of an expectation. And he said, we get apeksha bhanga because our apeksha was wrong. That is the reason of our apeksha bhanga. Apeksha was wrong. Your expectation was wrong. So it could not materialize. And if it materializes, your attachment grows. That also mind you. You gave him what he deserved. His own karma got it for him. Your karma made you the carrier thereof. Why should we be proud of having given away something? You are the porter that carried the money or other kind of gift, and the world deserved it by its own karma. Where is then the reason for pride in you? There is nothing very great in which you give into the world. When you have acquired the feeling of non-attachment, you have to acquire this feeling. These are all efforts. That is what Karma Yoga means. All these are mental efforts. There will then be neither good nor evil for you. It is only selfishness that causes the difference between good and evil. It is a very hard thing to understand. But you will come to learn in time that nothing in the universe has power over you until you allow it to exercise such a power. If you do not expect, then no power exerts over you. Nothing has power over the self of man, capital S, real nature. Until the self becomes a fool and loses independence. So by non-attachment you overcome and deny the power of anything to act upon you. If there is no small self, no attachment, that is the lesson Swamiji driving again and again. It is very easy to say that nothing has the right to act upon you until you allow it to do so. But what is the true sign of the man who really does not allow anything to work upon him? Who is neither happy nor unhappy when acted upon by the external world? The sign is that good or ill fortune causes no change in his mind. In all conditions, he continues to remain the same. In Swamiji's complete verse, in one place, Buddha's example is given beautiful. Anyway, I'll tell it on the next turn. Our time is getting over. I have to make an important announcement. Tomorrow is Holy Mother Sarada Devi's birthday. And this very Advaita Ashram has arranged my lecture. Time is 4:30, please, not 5:30, and that you have to remember. Tomorrow's lecture on Holy Mother is at 4:30. And the link has been sent to all of you. Advaita Ashram has sent or I have sent. So I invite you to tomorrow's lecture, which is at 4:30. This last sentence I will take up again in the next class on Thursday. Om Paratatve Sadalino Ramakrishna Samagaya Yo Dharma Sthapana Rato Viresham Dham Namamyaham Om शांति 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 हरि ओम तत्सत श्री रामकृष्ण अर्पणमस्तु।